Assalamualaikum students. Today we will discuss the histology of large intestine. Now, large intestine is the part of GIT tract that has following important functions. Absorption of water, number one. As the chyme reaches the large intestine, it is still in fluid in nature. Now, however, most of the water from the chyme is absorbed back into the circulation, which results in formation of the semi-solid fecal mass that is eliminated from the body by excretion through the anus. Number two is digestion. Although the large intestine does not produce digestive enzymes, the process of digestion continues in its lumen as a result of activity of the enzymes already present in the food material as it reaches the large intestine. Now, the bacteria which are normally present in large intestine also facilitates the digestive process by decomposing some of those food materials which are not digested in small intestine. The final products of digestion are absorbed by the enterocytes. Now, absorption of various other substances like electrolytes. And another important function is the production and absorption of vitamins. Now, the gut microbes of the large intestine, it produces small quantities of many vitamins, which includes vitamin K, vitamin B1, vitamin B2, vitamin B6, B12, and biotin. And now, from the lumen of the large intestine, these vitamins are absorbed into the circulation. Now, last function of the large intestine, very important function, the formation, temporary storage, and transport of fecal matter. Now, this matter is finally discharged through the anus, so to the exterior as feces. And in doing so, for the purpose of elimination, the production of mucus is increased in the large intestine. Large intestine, it starts from the ileocecal junction where the ileum meets the cecum. Now, cecum is the first part of the large intestine. Now, the other parts of large intestine are the ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, and then the sigmoid colon, rectum, and the anal canal. The colon and the cecum, they are indistinguishable histologically. And therefore, we will study the cecum and the ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, and sigmoid colon under one heading, that is the histological features of the colon. And the histological section of the rectum will be studied separately, and the anal canal also we will study it separately. Now, one of the features of the colon is the presence of tinea coli. You can see tinea coli. This is a band of muscles outside the three bands of muscles which are lying longitudinally outside the colon. And you can see here the diameter of the colon is larger and there are sacculations in the wall of the colon. Logical structure of wall of colon. The wall of colon also consists of the typical four coats of digestive tract, that is the mucosa, submucosa, muscularis externa, and serosa or adventitia. So here you can see this is the mucosa, and in mucosa you can well observe that there are no villi or no plica circularis. Then the submucosa, this is the submucosal layer. Mucosa consists of the epithelium, lamina propria, and muscularis mucosae. So three layers comprises the mucosa of the large intestine, which is devoid of villi and the plica circularis. Then the submucosa. Submucosa is again same as the in the wall of the small intestine. That is the connective tissue, dense connective tissue, blood vessels, nerves, lymphatics, myenteric Meissner's plexus. Then the muscularis externa also consists of two layers, but there are some differences we will observe when we will study the muscularis externa layer. Then last is the serosa or adventitia. So some parts of the colon are covered by the peritoneum. So the last layer is the serosa in this case, and some parts are devoid of peritoneum. So the last layer in these parts are known as adventitia. Mucosa of the colon. The mucosa of the colon has no plica circularis and no villi. So here you can see that its mucosa is flat, no plica circularis and no villi. It is lined by simple columnar epithelium, which contains columnar absorptive cells called the colonocytes and the goblet cells. The lamina propria contains a large number of crypts of Leiberkens. So you can see the crypts of Leiberkens. They are visible here, the intestinal glands. They are visible here. The lamina propria, the upper one third of each of the three crypts is lined by colonocytes and the goblet cells. Now in the lower part, lower thirds of these glands are present mainly the goblet cells. Some enteroendocrine cells and the undifferentiated stem cells are also present in the deeper parts of these glands. But Paneth cells are entirely absent. So a point to be noted that crypts of Leiberkens in the large intestine lacks Paneth cells. So other structures, other components of the lamina propria are the connective tissue, blood vessels, nerves, lymphatics, and then the last layer is the, again, a very important feature of this layer is the presence of the mucosa associated lymphoid tissue, MALT, which occurs as diffusely spread lymphocytes as well as lymphoid nodules. The muscularis mucosae is a thin layer of smooth muscles consisting of inner circular and outer longitudinal layer. Here you can see the mucosa, the flat mucosa with the epithelial lining, and you can well appreciate the crypts of Leiberkens or the intestinal glands of large intestine. One thing here to note is the shape of the intestinal glands. They appear to be like test tubes. This. So some authors describe them as having test tube shape with upper one third part is covered by the enterocytes, colonocytes and the goblet cells, while the lower part goblet cells are abundant, and then the stem cells and some endocrine cells are also present, and no Paneth cells are here. Mucosa of the colon. Now this is a transverse section of colon showing the wall of the layers of the wall of the colon. This is the mucosa. This is the mucosa, and this layer is the submucosa. So submucosa, it consists of dense connective tissue. Now it contains some larger blood vessels, lymphatics, and the Meissner's plexus of nerves. Muscularis externa of colon, it consists of the inner circular and outer longitudinal layer of smooth muscles. Now this is the usual arrangement of smooth muscles in the muscularis externa of GI tract, but there is an unusual thing about it, that most of the muscle fibers of the outer longitudinal layer are gathered into three thick band, flat bands known as tenia coli. So you can see here in the three bands, the outer longitudinal layer is arranged in the form of three bands, the tenia coli. These three muscular bands are equidistant and are separated from each other by a very thin layer of longitudinally running smooth muscle fibers. The constant tonus in the strong tinea coli produces folding of the colon into sacculations called Hustra coli. Now, the horstrations of the colon is due to the constant strong contraction, tonus contraction of the tinea coli. The myenteric plexus of nerves lie between the inner circular and outer longitudinal layers. So, somewhere here lies the myenteric plexus. In the second picture, this is also a histological section of colon. You can well appreciate the inner circular and the outer longitudinal layer, which is arranged in the form of thin bands known as tinea coli. So the serosa or adventitial layer, the last layer of the colon, the transverse colon and the sigmoid colon are completely surrounded by serosa, because they are covered completely by the peritoneum. The anterior surface of the ascending and descending colon is covered by serosa, that is the visceral peritoneum, while their posterior surface is covered by an adventitial layer of dense connective fibrous tissue. The serosa of colon is characterized by presence of numerous small protuberances called the appendices epiploiki, which are composed of the fatty tissue. So, histological section of rectum. Now, rectum, it consists of, it resembles the colon. That is, it has got all the four layers, the mucosa, the muscularis, this is the mucosa here, muscularis submucosa, then the muscularis externa, and last layer is serosa or adventitia. Now, it is different from the colon except the following features. The rectal mucosa contains fewer but longer glands. They have fewer but longer glands, longer crypts of Lieberkin. The outer longitudinal layer of muscularis externa is of uniform thickness and it does not show the tinea coli. And most of the rectum is covered by the connective tissue, adventitia only. The adventitia, only the anterior and lateral surface of the upper third of rectum have a serosal covering, that is the visceral layer of the peritoneum. Now, this is the section of the mucosa of the colon, and this is the section of the mucosa of the rectum. And you can see here, the glands are test tube shaped, and they are more. But here in the rectum, the glands, they are longer. That's why they are more cut sections visible. And these glands have got more goblet cells in them as compared to the colon, because of the colon. The ratio of goblet cell increases in the rectum. They lie in ratio of 1:1 with the colonocytes. So why is there increased amount of the goblet cells in the rectum? You have to give me the reason in the assignment. So the appendix, it is a blind ending tubular diverticulum of cecum. Here you can see this is the cecum part of the large intestine, and this is the blind ending tube, the vermiform appendix. It is covered by peritoneum. Its outer surface is wholly covered by the peritoneum, visceral layer of peritoneum, and it has got a narrow lumen. Layers of the wall of appendix, it consists of all the four layers, typical coats of the digestive tract, that is the mucosa, submucosa, muscularis externa, and serosa. Now, in cross section, the appendix is characterized by thick wall. In cross section, the appendix, it is characterized by thick wall and narrow lumen, which is star shaped or irregular in outline.
So you can see here the wall is thick as compared to the lumen, and lumen is irregular or it can be star shaped.
The intestinal villi, they are absent. The mucosa is lined mainly by absorptive cells. Only a few goblet cells are present. The lamina propria contains crypts of Lieberkin, which are lined by columnar absorptive as well as the goblet cells. So some of the crypts of Lieberkin are there, you can see here. Now, the characteristic feature of the mucosa of the appendix is the presence of lymphatic nodules. So these are the, here you can see the lymphatic nodules with germinal centers in the lamina propria. Now the next layer is the submucosa, again the same, and the next layer is muscularis externa, which is inner circular and outer longitudinal, and then the serosa. So appendix is wholly covered by the serosa. Now in newborn child, the mucosa of the appendix lodges the mucosa associated lymphoid tissue, but does not exhibit nodular lymphoid tissue. The lymphoid follicles begin to develop soon after birth. The nodular lymphatic tissue in the lamina propria of the mucosa of appendix of a child or young adult is present as large secondary lymphatic nodules showing germinal centers. These nodules protrude towards the lumen of the appendix, due to which the appendicular lumen appears star-shaped in the transverse section. So this question is often asked in the viva, that the lumen of the appendix, how it appears and why. So these are due to the presence of large lymphatic nodules, the star-shaped lumen, irregular lumen. Now some of the lymphatic nodules, they pierce the muscularis mucosae, and they can project up into the mucosa of the submucosa of the appendix. Now lymphoid tissue of the appendix gradually regress after 20 years of age, and only traces of lymphoid tissue are present in the appendix of elderly person. Now the muscularis externa of appendix is thin but shows the usual inner circular and outer longitudinal layer of the smooth muscles. Tinea coli are absent. Serosa, it forms the outermost layer of the appendix. Now a question arises, why, if the appendix is a vestigial organ, why there are so much lymphoid tissue in it? So you have to tell me in your assignment.